reached a bed. That's Turtle's favorite song.
Oh, is it?
Oh, okay. Oh, let's hope and pray you've not got a disease off of him. 429. I think
so.
Oh, yeah? Oh, really?
And you'll say, Pastor Tim, how in the world did you remember that? Folks, I've got Turtle's number.
Which one are you going to sing, Susan?
Now, how many of these verses do you want to sing? Do you just want to do two so we do more songs? Just two verses of each one? If you want to do more, do you want to do it that way?
Yeah.
That way we'll get more different songs in. Instead,
yeah.
78 in the white book has two verses to it. The two verses are not in the blue book. 78. It's rumored that the people that work at the Hershey Chocolate Factory sing this quite often. There's a sweet, sweet spirit.
Thank you.
Chuck has talked about just coming up to the church and sitting in the church. When he gets thrown out of the house, his house at home, he at least senses the presence of the Lord here. Just kidding that.
That's right.
He doesn't get thrown out. But he said he does come and sit here, and he senses the Lord's presence.
I'll tell you, I've come here, Betsy and I have come here when nobody's here, and you feel it. You know it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know he's here.
Yes. Amen. Although Sandra came up recently to make copies of the bulletin, nobody's here, and she had to go to the back. She said, it's kind of spooky.
It does. It's so dark. Just don't be here when I show up. You'll scare me.
Robin loves to
been
do
there,
that.
Done it.
She'll hide just around the corner of somebody walks around.
She's done it to me.
Oh, really?
Did Janet and Clyde show you the picture that they had on their phone?
No.
Somebody came Halloween and they didn't even know who it was. It was spooky looking.
Really?
Yeah.
Scary.
Yeah.
They had a picture on their phone?
Came to their house. They didn't even know who it was.
Okay.
All in weird clothes and face. It wasn't me.
Did they give them candy?
You have another song you'd like to sing? I hope you got a whole bunch of them. Because I've got some that I want to do a little story with.
101.
101. White book?
White book, yeah, please.
101 white book. I must tell Jesus. First and last, still okay?
Yeah, I'll be fine.
Prosperous Irish family, Scriven is Irish, Scriven, on September the 10th, 1819, Joseph Scriven successfully completed the requirements for entrance to Trinity College in Dublin. But after attending for only a short time, he decided to leave and join the army. His military career, however, was cut short by poor health, and he returned to Trinity College, where he earned his Bachelor of Arts degree. With his education behind him and a long and happy life ahead, Joseph Scriven decided to wed his sweetheart. But the night before their wedding, tragedy struck. Scriven's fiance was thrown from the horse she was riding and into a river where she was drowned. Overcome with grief, Scriven became despondent and introspective and withdrew from his friends and family. He made the decision to leave the religious tradition of his parents in favor of those of the Plymouth Brethren. In connection with that decision, he determined to leave his homeland and migrate to Canada in 1844 at the age of 25. With the move, Scriven refocused his life to concentrate on living the lifestyle described by Christ in the Sermon on the Mount. He became a servant of the underprivileged, assisting the handicapped, the poverty-stricken, the ill, and the imprisoned. He cut and hauled wood for destitute families so they might survive the frigid winters of Port Hope, Ontario. Although he was respected by the townspeople for his deeds of mercy, he was viewed as an eccentric and was not integrated into their fellowship. Nonetheless, Scriven met and fell in love with a young Canadian woman and again planned to marry. But before the wedding took place, once more tragedy struck as the young woman contracted pneumonia and died. At the same time, Scriven received news that his mother, back in Dublin, was seriously ill. He did not have the funds to finance a trip home, so he wrote the three verses of a poem he entitled, Pray Without Ceasing, and sent them to his mother, hoping they would lift her spirits and comfort her. Sometime later, when Scriven himself was confined to his bed with illness, a neighbor stopped in to see him. As they talked, the friend saw a paper at the side of the bed with the words of Scriven's poem scrawled on it. After reading the poem, the man inquired if Scriven had written it. He replied, "The Lord and I did it between us." Securing Scriven's permission, the neighbor saw to it that the poem was published in a small collection of poetry called Hymns and Other Verses. Sometime later, Charles Converse, which is on that page, a well-known composer of that day, wrote a melody for the verses Scriven had penned. The hymn was then retitled, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, after the first line of the text. On a cold morning in October of 1886, the body of Joseph Scriven was found in Rice Lake in Bodley, Ontario. He had departed from his lonely life and gone to be with his best friend, Jesus. And in his memory, the citizens of Port Hope, Ontario, erected a simple monument. On its face, they inscribed the words of Scriven's hymn. The last line reflects the author's hope. And the quote they put was, "In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there."
Down in a lake.
Mm-hmm. Huh. He had apparently drowned. So now, as Paul Hardy would say, you know the rest of the story.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good day. So, and again, in some ways, they did this song a disservice when they named it What a Friend We Have in Jesus, because you won't think that it's talking about the friendship that we have in Jesus. But if you look at the words of the song, it's a song that talks about prayer. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And all three verses, kind of that same thought. It's a song really about prayer. It's entitled about friendship, and Jesus is a wonderful friend. But it's really talking about our need for prayer. Sing the first couple, the first and last verses. Say about these sort of crushing blows, they can either make you bitter or better.
Yeah.
And you make the choice. How about another song? I've got two more stories I can share later about songs.
You got face to face in that book? No, I mean in your book of stories.
It doesn't, well, I don't know that it's, I know in the front it's not listed as having the titles of the song. I don't know if there's an index in the back.
Hard to find.
No. That would be neat to know all the stories.
It would be. If it's in here, I don't know.
Okay, I got it. But it's 520.
520? Okay. 520. 520 in the white book. Face to face.
Thank you.
that you, Jesus? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? Seeing Jesus face to face? Jesus, that's you? It's an awesome thought, isn't it?
Did you ever see that young girl that painted his face? Some young girl. She said she was...
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I forget her name. She was foreign.
Yes. She's very gifted,
yes.
Very talented.
Yes. I don't remember her name, though.
And yet, I've told you folks before that one of my criticisms oftentimes of the portrayals of Jesus are that Jesus is kind of a nice-looking fellow. And what does Isaiah the prophet say? Isaiah the prophet says there was nothing about him that we should be drawn unto him. Mm-hmm. You know, no form or comeliness that we should really find him attractive. So, mm-hmm. I mean, I don't... Mm-hmm. You think I might get struck dead by lightning if I say that Jesus might have been ugly. Well, absolutely, but I'm just trying to point out that oftentimes that's the way we portray him in the movies, mm-hmm. and in the pictures.
Yeah.
That, and in fact, most of the ones like you see where he's sitting there and he's kind of looking up and he's got the long, what is his hair like? It's kind of a light brown,
mm-hmm.
and it's straight.
Yeah.
And is there a problem with that? That's the European version of him.
Oh, yeah.
But Jesus is from the Middle East.
Right.
So what was his complexion most likely? And what was his hair mostly like?
Dark and kinky.
Yeah.
Like my dad.
Yeah, and I'm not trying, I'm just trying to say that oftentimes we get these stereotypes, and
his
I understand.
His nose is probably big too, I would guess.
Yeah, well.
Dad's from there.
Yeah, your dad's from there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
When we lived in Florida, we had friends that during an Easter program, they put him on a cross. What's his name? I forget his name.
Mark.
No.
Mark.
Mark. He was a thin, little, skinny guy. And on that cross, he looked so much like Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Pictures.
And him and his wife lived there. They had a home, they had a job. And they gave up everything. They are now in the middle of West Virginia with a camp that they have built for children.
Mount Nebo.
Okay. We've been to the camp.
Okay.
And every year he adds a building, a swimming pool, adds something. And I don't know how they do it.
Yeah, you have to have contributions, and that's wonderful when people are obedient
yeah.
to the Lord.
But he gave up everything
yeah.
and left his family, as he had some children, left them there in Florida, and came up there. And how he got to Mount Nebo, I don't know, but it's up in a mountain. You have to go up an old road to get to where he's at, but he has a camp up there, and every summer he has, it's open to the children that need help.
Okay. Wonderful. Praise the Lord.
Help him out a little bit.
Praise the Lord. Face to face with Christ my Savior. How about another song? Do you want me to give you another song and another story?
Yeah. I like it.
Okay.
I do too. I like that. The song and the story.
How about, this is a lady at the nursing home down here. She will ask for this song, God Will Take Care of You. You know the song?
Yeah.
I don't know what page it is in the book. In the white book, it is.
He has.
Absolutely. God Will Take Care of You. 426 white book. 426 white book. Is it also that same page in the blue book? 426 in the white. If it's 426 in the blue, then that'd be awesome. But here's what it says about this. And by the way, it's interesting that this book was put out by Brodmann Press, Nashville, Tennessee. I think that's what it said. It says hymns used by permission of Brodmann Press. But the book was actually printed in Nashville by Ideals Publication. But this is what it said. In the field of Christian ministry, there have been many husband and wife teams that have worked together to spread the gospel. Savella Mark named her husband Stillman, were just such a couple. Sibylla was born August 21st, 1869 in Nova Scotia. She was educated there and then went on to study music and teach school before her marriage to Stillman. Stillman at the time of their marriage, was an ordained Baptist minister, having received his college education at Harvard University. Dr. and Mrs. Martin traveled throughout the United States, holding evangelistic meetings and Bible conferences. Mrs. Martin assisted her husband with the teaching and also contributed hymn texts appropriate to the subjects of his sermon on occasions. In 1904, the Martins and their young son were spending several weeks in Leicestershire, New York, at the Practical Bible Training School. Dr. Martin was collaborating with the president of the school, John Davis, in the preparation of a gospel songbook for use in Bible meetings. During the stay in Leicestershire, Sibylla became very ill and was confined to her bed. Stillman had a preaching engagement one evening when she seemed especially weak and was considering canceling it because of her condition. As they discussed the situation, their young son quietly entered the room and stood listening. Suddenly piped up, "Father, don't you think that if God wants you to preach today, he will take care of Mother while you are away?" The boy's words of assurance and childlike faith gave Dr. Martin the encouragement he needed to keep his preaching commitment. Faithful to his congregation, Stillman kept his appointment to preach, and several in the crowd were so moved by his message from the Bible that they made professions of faith in Christ at the close of his sermon. Feeling that God had certainly blessed his preaching, Dr. Martin hurried home to share the good news with his wife and son. When he entered the house where they were staying, he found that his wife had not only improved remarkably, but she had also had the energy and inspiration to write a hymn text based on the words their son had spoken to them earlier in the day. She had entitled the text, "God Will Take Care of You," and she handed it to her husband with a smile as he asked how she was feeling. There was a small portable organ in the house, and Stillman took the sheet with the verses on it, placed it on the instrument, and began composing a melody to accompany his wife's text. Before long, he had written a lovely melody. He gathered a couple of other teachers from the school. Together, they sang the new hymn that very evening. They were also enthusiastic about the encouraging message of the words and the blending of text and melody that they performed the hymn at the Bible Training School later in the week. The students and teachers were equally as impressed with the Martin's hymn, and John Davis suggested they include it in the songbook that they were compiling. Thus it was that "God Will Take Care of You" was published in 1905 in the book Songs of Redemption and Praise. From that time to the present, this hymn of comfort has been a favorite of Christians everywhere. God will take care of you. Absolutely. So we'll sing first and last verse. God will take care of you.
cost you is?
Yes, ma'am. 169 in the blue book, I think.
White book,
what page?
169.
169 white book, that's right. 169 white book.
Orange used to sing that a lot.
Yeah.
You remember when the song came out?
Beverly Shea was still living. It was up on a stage at some baseball field, but I don't know what year it was.
Do you know that the song has already been out 50 years now?
No, is that something?
If you look at the bottom, copyright 1971.
Okay.
By the Gaithers. This song, which was new when I was growing up, it is now 50 years old. And I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. 50 years? Yeah. Because
you got old, but you didn't.
They had a revival. And that was the entertainment, you know, for the revival.
Okay.
Is when they sang that song.
And it's really good.
I know it's been years.
Yes, and what a song. What a powerful song. And because he lives, we can face tomorrow.
Beverly Shea's been gone for a long time, too.
Actually, I think it's been maybe within the past 10 years that he passed away.
I think it was longer than that.
Has it been that? Maybe Sheila can, well, she can't do it on her phone. But one of y'all can check it out, George Beverly Shea. But, yeah, he was.
He has a unique story of his own.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
My wife and I, that's the song she introduced me to.
Is that right?
Yeah, when she came.
Praise the Lord. I know it's very inspirational. Great song. Could you go on with life if you thought that that was all that there was?
What is it?
Could you go on with life if you thought that once a person died, there was all that there was? It would be. You stand near the grave, and then you begin to ask, what's the meaning of life?
You asked us a while back, I don't remember when you asked us, when we get to heaven, who do we want to see?
I have a list.
Amen.
I want to see Susie.
Yes. John? Yeah. And I'll go ahead and share this story with you, because this kind of touches upon it. The song, More Love to Thee. Are you acquainted with it? In the book, it is on page, looks like 247. And I'm sharing this story now. It will become apparent in verse in just a second. The author of this hymn, Elizabeth Pison Prentice, was born in Portland, Maine on October 26, 1818. At an early age, Elizabeth demonstrated a gift for writing both prose and poetry, and in 1834, at the age of 16, she became a regular contributor to the popular literary magazine, Youth's Companion. After completing her formal education, Elizabeth took jobs teaching in both Massachusetts and Virginia. It was during this time in her life that she met and married Dr. George L. Prentice, a Presbyterian minister. Elizabeth, although not a minister by profession, certainly carried on a great ministry of her own through her writings on Christian themes. One of her books, Stepping Heavenward, was written for young people. It outlines the techniques of living the Christian life and describes the biblical view of the life hereafter. Shortly after its publication, this book reached sales of over 200,000 copies, earning it the reputation of a bestseller. Although Elizabeth suffered from chronically poor health, she did safely deliver three children and considered her life at home complete and fulfilling. In 1856, however, a devastating epidemic swept New York, claiming the lives of two of her beloved children. Elizabeth was grief-stricken by the tragic loss and wrote the following poem. I thought that prattling boys and girls would fill this empty room, that my rich heart would gather flowers from childhood's opening bloom. One child and two green graves are mine. This is God's gift to me. A bleeding, fainting, broken heart. This is my gift to thee. It was also during this time of deep grieving that Elizabeth found solace in the comforting hymn by Sarah Adams, Nearer, My God, to Thee. Using an almost identical meter, she penned the verses to her well-loved hymn, More Love to Thee. She did not intend for it to be more than a communication between herself and her Savior. She did not even show the text to her husband until 13 years later, when he was serving as a professor at Union Theological Seminary in New York City. Dr. Prentice liked the hymn and encouraged his wife to publish it. That year, 1869, it was printed for the first time in a religious leaflet. The following year, More Love to Thee was published with music in a collection titled Songs of Devotion, published by William H. Doane. It quickly gained in popularity and became a favorite hymn of dedication used widely by preachers and teachers during the religious revival of 1870. The philosophy expressed in the hymn's verses faithfully reflects that of its author. For despite her pain and discouragement, both physical and emotional, Elizabeth Prentice found she could still experience great joy in expressing her love to God. Among her writings is the following reflection. To love Christ more is the deepest need, the constant cry of my soul. Out in the woods and on my bed and out driving, when I am happy and busy and when I am sad and idle, the whisper keeps going up for more love, more love, more love. And so it's a song that has deep significance in light of the fact that she lost two of her own children, and yet rather than turning from God, she turned to God. So we'll sing a couple verses of it. More love to thee.
Thank you.
story?
No, there's other stories in there, but I mean, I didn't really take time to think of any other ones. They've got lots of other, and in fact, every story in here, every song that they have in here, has a story about it.
Tell us another story.
You want me to find you one?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you're already aware of the story about, well, you may not know this part. Amazing Grace was written by John Newton. John Newton, well, let me tell you about it. In the summer of 1725, right, so we were formed as a country in 1776, so this is 50 years before then. In the city of London, England, John Newton was born, so 50 years before we filed for independence. His mother, a devout member of the dissenters, taught the young boy to pray and filled his mind with the scriptures, but it was John's father, an often absent sea captain, who captured the boy's imagination. John dreamed of sailing ships in the wild, wide seas, of adventures and mysterious destinations. Just before John's seventh birthday, his mother became ill and died, leaving her son a virtual orphan. Taken in by distant relatives, the little boy was mocked for his belief in God, discouraged from praying, and ridiculed for his childish faith. Unhappy and lonely, John turned again to his dreams of the sea, and at the age of 11, ran off to become an apprentice of his father's ship. If it was a close father-son relationship John desired, he was sadly disappointed. For like his foster family, his father also rejected him. For years, the young fellow plied the Mediterranean on sailing ships, enjoying all the experiences and immoralities offered in each exotic port. He was frequently fired for insubordination, but just as frequently hired by another ship's master, eager for young seamen and not too particular about their character. After a short stint in the British Navy, John deserted and ran away to Africa to seek his fortune and new adventures in the African slave trade. Signing on with an unscrupulous slave dealer, he found his situation had declined dramatically. In the slave trader's absences, John was left in the care of the man's vindictive wife, who imprisoned him in her quarters, beat him, and forced him to eat his food from the floor like a dog. Believing death was preferable to this kind of treatment, John escaped from his prison into the West African forests and eventually made his way to the Atlantic coast. After lighting signal fires, John was finally spotted by a passing ship's captain, who sent a small boat to shore to pick him up. The captain had hoped the lone man had gold or ivory to offer and was disappointed to receive instead a penniless runaway. Putting him to work as a mate, the captain learned later, was an unwise decision. Becoming bored during a particularly long watch, John broke into the ship's supply of rum and generously shared it with the crew. Again demonstrating his lack of discipline, John downed a goodly amount of the liquor, became totally disoriented, and fell overboard. One of the ship's officers, either out of pity or spite, saved John from drowning by spearing him in the thigh with a harpoon and reeling him back aboard like a flailing fish. Painfully wounded and severely disciplined, Newton was relegated below decks where it was thought he could be no more trouble. It was a miserable journey from Africa to England in the stifling, stinking hold, and John had endless days and nights to ponder his empty life and unfulfilled dreams. Somehow, a copy of Thomas A. Kempis's book, Imitation of Christ, fell into his hands. Reading the book awakened his conscience to the things of God, and he began to recall some of the early lessons learned at his mother's knee. As the ship neared Scotland, severe winds and rains battered her, and she began to take on water. Desperate measures were taken to keep her from sinking, and for days, every able-bodied man, slave or free, bailed water from the foundering ship. Exhausted, frightened, and facing certain death, John Newton had a life-transforming experience with God. The assurance of God's love flooded his soul. Later, he would describe it as a miracle, an amazing manifestation of God's grace. Although that voyage was not his last, John Newton's heart became drawn in other directions. 2 years after his miraculous conversion, he married Mary Catlett, a devout Christian, and not long after that, John left the sea for good and became a minister. While he loved to preach and tended his little flock of believers with zealous care, his great joy was writing hymns to be sung at his weekly prayer meetings. He composed over 280 hymns, but the one for which he is most remembered came from his shipboard conversion and carries the message of his personal experience, Amazing Grace. Which they also say that, and this is from Wintley Phipps on one of the Gaither videos, they think that the melody for the song came from the slaves. That was a song that they would oftentimes sing. And they said that if you go to a piano, those of you that don't know much about the piano, but of course you know there's white and black keys. This song is based on the black keys. If you play it in the key of G flat, you can basically play all of the notes of Amazing Grace on those five keys, and you can also play it with basically three chords that you can play on those black keys. So it is a song that's related to the slave trade. So, and it might be a fitting song for us to end on. I'm not going to play it in the key of G flat. I guess maybe I could, but play it in the key of A flat. Father, it has been good being in your house tonight, and be reminded of these songs we may find ourselves as we go about our daily activities, humming a tune. And we'll remember what words that we can, Father, but they are songs that are meant to encourage us in our faith. And it's been inspiring to read where these songs originated from. Father, and we may not stop to think about most all the songs we sing were written because of personal experiences that people had. Whether it was Joseph Scriven with, you know, the loss of two of his fiancées and losing his mother. Father, that those experiences in life have either turned him away from you or turned him further toward you. And we're thankful, Father, that it turned him toward you. And that we can know that whenever we have a need, we can go to you. And even if we're disappointed, to know that you understand. We're thankful for songs like More Love to Thee. They remind us, Father, that even in the heart of heartaches, what we need more is more of a love for you, because you are our hope. We also give you thanks for John Newton and what he was able to write, and for the lady that ended up writing the song for God Will Take Care of You. Father, we pray that you'll put a song in our heart that will keep us thinking about you and being reminded that we owe everything to you. We love you. We thank you for what you do. Continue to meet our needs. Meet the needs of those in our bulletin. There are a lot of different needs. We ask you to bless each person. And Father, we pray that you'll help us to be a witness wherever we go, that people might come to know you. Thank you for giving us this time. Dismiss us with your blessing. Bring us back the next appointed time. And until then, use us for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.